Senator Obama's support among working, hardworking Americans, white Americans, is weakening again, and how the whites in both states who had not completed college were supporting me, and in independence, I was running even with him and doing even better with Democratic-leaning independents. I have a much broader base to build a winning coalition on.
Now, that's not exactly the argument that left-wingers are going to embrace. At the same time, longtime Clinton mouthpiece Paul Begala says that the Democratic Party isn't going to win if they only get the support of, quote, eggheads and African Americans. Sounds like an electoral strategy to me. Well, anyway, joining us now with more on this, former Clinton advisor Dick Barnes. This is getting bad as it relates to race and the Democratic
Party. It
reminds
me of the old days of Frank Rizzo in Philadelphia, who said, vote white. I mean, when she says white,
well, first she says hardworking Americans, white Americans, right after that.
And she's then, first of all, the implication is not black welfare queens who are supporting Obama. And the white hardworking Americans, this is an overtly racist appeal. She so far has been subliminally racist, but here she's absolutely coming right out and saying it. Vote white.
Bill Clinton complained that, quote, the Obama campaign played the race card against him and that there's the evidence to prove it. In other words, that this had been a strategy. He claimed that on the campaign trail.
But that's ridiculous. He set it up with his comments and he made it possible. She is using the identification of whites vis-a-vis blacks to polarize the society racially and win the election.
Well, it's sad for the country to, you know, you write in your column here about Hillary staying in this race, and Dick always has a good theory, so you got to pay attention to what he says. He said her continuing in the race, you don't think she has any chance of winning, which she can't. She's going to continue to bash Barack Obama in the hopes of damaging him so he can't win the general election to keep her option alive for 2012.
Yep.
You really believe that?
Yeah. It's like a hunting license. As long as she's running, she can shoot Obama. Once she gets out of the race, she has to say good things about Obama.
Yeah.
But she's got 30 days more to bash him and to set up this racial polarization that she is in this quote that might make it impossible for him to win.
Don't you think you might be reading something into something that she did not?
Of course not. She
imply?
Used that word white deliberately. She even stuttered over it, and then she repeated it. This is very close to Frank Rizzo's line, vote white.
Okay, I have a choice between a truly inspirational speaker who has not done the kind of spade work.
Give me a break. This whole thing is the biggest fairy tale I've ever seen.
Good evening, I'm Chris Matthews. Welcome to Harbaugh. Author Toni Morrison once dubbed him the first black president, but now Bill Clinton is getting slammed by one of the most influential African-American leaders in the country. South Carolina Congressman James Clyburn told the New York Times that most African-Americans believe the Clintons, quote, are committed to doing everything they possibly can to damage Obama to a point that he could never win. That means killing his chances even if he wins the Democratic nomination.
That Toni Morrison statement in The New Yorker, more has been made of that. The foundation of that is pretty thin. He was never a black president. He's a fleshy white guy.
You know, that's the over-the-top way to explain it. He had great chemistry with the black community.
He did. He did, but it's ironic. But African Americans have stood by him through thick and thin, and I would assume that any black Democrat right now has just said, we're finished.
How about
with
that
this
retarded guy he executed on the way to the White House? Never forgot that baby when he went back home and executed the guy who had no mental capacity. Mm-hmm. And that's a liberal or that's a Democrat?
Took time out from his busy schedule to go have the guy killed.
Bill Clinton was sending back Haitian refugees who were fleeing a regime that was armed by the United States. He was welcoming Cubans to Florida because he needed the Florida electoral vote. But he was violating international law, sending Haitians back without examining to discover, to discern whether they were legitimate political refugees or not, meaning they were fleeing with a well-founded fear for their lives. and he knew many of them were being killed by FRAP and those killers in Haiti that had been armed by the United States. These matters are larger than race. We're talking about being sensitive to the interest of humankind. And so I think we want a president who has a vigorous intellectual curiosity and an overarching decency and humanity.
Toni Morrison, you owe Black America an absolute apology. That is the dumbest thing I've ever heard in my life. Because if Bill Clinton was a Black president, he wouldn't have thrown Monte Guinier under the bus, his so-called friend. If he was the first Black president, he wouldn't have let 400,000 people in Rwanda die if he was so-called the first Black president.
But he also, just for accuracy, it's 800,000.
Bill Clinton felt their pain, retrospectively. In 1998, on his grand apology tour of Africa, a whirlwind tour of whirlwind apologies for slavery, the Cold War, you name it, he touched down in Kigali and apologized for the Rwandan genocide. When you look at those children who greeted us, he said, biting his lip, as is his wont, how could anyone say they did not want those children to have a chance to have their own children? Alas, the president had precisely identified the problem. In April 1994, when the Hutu genociders looked at the children who greeted them in the Tutsi villages, that's exactly what they thought. They didn't want those Tutsi children to have a chance to have their own children. So the question is, when a bunch of killers refuse to subscribe to multicultural mumbo jumbo, what do? All over the world there were people like me sitting in offices, continued Bill in his apology aria, who did not fully appreciate the depth and the speed with which you were being engulfed by this unimaginable terror. Au contraire, he appreciated it all too fully. That's why, during the bloodbath, Clinton administration officials were specifically instructed not to use the word genocide, lest it provoke public pressure to do something. Documents made public last week confirmed that US officials knew within the first few days that a final solution to eliminate all Tutsis was underway. Stan in America. Clinton, Clark and Rwanda, 10 years on.
We have every reason to believe that acts of genocide have occurred.
How many acts of genocide does it take to make genocide?
Alan, that's just not a question that I'm in a position to answer.
True that that you have specific guidance not to use the word genocide in isolation, but always to preface it with this word acts of.
I have guidance which I try to use as best as I can. There are formulations that we are using that we are trying to be consistent in our use of. I don't have an absolute categorical prescription.
Ils ont massacré 1 million de personnes en l'espace de 100 jours. Lors d'un voyage au Rwanda début 1998, le président Clinton s'est excusé devant le monde entier pour être resté spectateur du génocide. Cette fois, il utilise le mot à 11 reprises.
We did not immediately call these crimes by their rightful names. Genocide.
Mais pour ceux qui ont survécu au génocide, les excuses seules ne suffisent pas.
They said the man is judged according to his works. So tell me, Africa, what's your worth? There's no money, no diamonds, no fortunes on this planet that can replace Rwanda, Rwanda, Rwanda.
We did not act quickly enough after the killing began.
These are the cries of the children. America, it's the United. United States of America.
Please, I talk about Rwanda, Rwanda.
Hillary Monster, historical reference, indeed. Samantha Power, Clinton and genocide. Power was rightfully awarded the Pulitzer for her finally written and downright horrifying book, A Problem from Hell, which, in macabre detail, describes the calculated indifference of the Clinton administration when 800,000 Rwandans were being systematically butchered. A reviewer of Power's book for the New York Times perhaps summed it up best, saying that the picture of Clinton that emerges from this reading is that of an amoral narcissist.